Before we get into the new material for today, I kind of want to rewind for a minute and make some points concerning accessible websites. First of all, accessibility relates to making websites work for people regardless of their abilities. All right. So it's not merely designing websites for people that are blind or people that are not blind or whatever. It's accommodating everyone to the best degree that you can. All right. And we're going to give some suggestions here. One point that I would like to raise is a lot of accessible web design is just good web design, right? For example, we talked about people with ADHD, and we talked about for someone like that, maybe having a simpler layout, less distractions is important. Well, guess what? That's also important for everyone, right? The simpler and the more straightforward you can present the material, the better off everyone's going to be. All right. No one wants a cluttered website. So you can say that you're doing it for people with ADHD, but you're also doing it for everyone else as well. So the principles of accessible web design, couple of things. First of all, they align for the most part with just plain good web design. They actually can be useful. Some of the things that you do for people with disabilities can be useful for people that don't have those disabilities, or maybe have a milder form of the disability, or some temporary condition. And thirdly, even if it's not useful to people that don't have disabilities, it's not going to be a hindrance to them. For example, like the Braille thing outside the door, to give a physical example. All right. You will probably never use the Braille numbers outside of the door here, all right? But it's not like it gets in your way. It's not like it makes it more difficult for you to find BU-205, all right? So either it's just good design to begin with, or it's designed for people with disabilities that also benefits people without disabilities under certain conditions, or at the very least, is ignorable, where it's, no big deal. All right. The two principles of universal design that we're going to talk about in terms of this is simplicity and multiple presentations. And I sort of decided that being able to customize a site sort of fits under multiple presentations, that you can make the site look a couple different ways depending on your preferences. All right, what do those mean? Well, simplicity, well, we should have an idea what that means, right? That means that the layout is clear, the layout is obvious. There's effective use of white space so things don't look clutter. That colors are used, perhaps, but colors are not used in a way that overwhelms the user. All right? Same thing with images, same thing with animations, and so on. Everything on the page is of some value, all right? That's an important concept. You don't put things on the page just because you think it would be cool to have it. You put things on the page because they add value to the page. So you're very careful about what you present, all right? And you don't have things that don't really add to the page. Because remember, if they don't add to the page, they subtract from it. Because they have the potential of distracting people away from what they probably should be looking at. So that's kind of where simplicity falls in. Most of the websites that we looked at that we said were bad websites weren't bad because they were too simple. They were bad because they were too complicated. All right? It would be possible to have too simple of a website, right? But the problem that people usually have is having too complicated of a website. So you use colors not just to have a bunch of colors on your page, but use it purposefully to designate the navigation section versus some other sections of the page. Multiple presentation is the ability to show the same thing a couple different ways. all right? And that might be something small, like, for example, I think in Canvas, I could be wrong, I know it used to be an angel when we had angel, I think it's true in Canvas too, you can configure your page to use a different color scheme, right? I think you can. All right. Well, guess what? You know, that could be cool just if you like certain colors, right? Studies have shown that if people like the way a website or even some product looks, that they'll be more satisfied with it. So the ability to customize is important regardless of disabilities. But for people with disabilities, they can customize the colors, the fonts, and so on to make it more easily readable by them. And that's a good thing. So that's one example of multiple presentations. Be able to look at the page with different designs, different color schemes, and so on. Another aspect of multiple presentations would be having things like showing an image as well as text about something. All right. So if there was a news story about, trying to think of a good news story, which is sometimes hard to do. All right, what would be a good news story? You know, Elsie opens a new building, right? We could have the text about that, but we could also have a photograph of that. Or we could have a text about it, or we could have an introductory video about it. All right, they'd be taking the same material and showing it two different ways. Now, these two things, again, may seem to contradict each other, because one, we're saying make it as simple as possible, and here we're saying, well, take the same information and show it a couple different ways. They don't contradict each other, all right? They are things that need to be balanced, however, all right? Einstein had a quote, I think it was Einstein, something to the effect of, things ought to be made as simple as can, but no simpler, all right? So in other words, when we talk about simplicity in web design, the phrase that I don't really like, but some people use it, is about like dumbing down the website, you know, making it so easy and so basic that you lose something from it, all right? And I don't think anyone is calling for that, you know. I had a student that would say, I had a student when I talked about this topic that said, why should I remove all the videos from my website just because blind people can't see them? And it was like, I'm not suggesting that. I'm simply suggesting to give blind people another way to get that information. So, yes, maybe you have a video, but you have a transcript of that video that their screen reader can read to them. All right? That would be an example of that. Or, again, a deaf person with a video where they can see the images but can't hear the narration, you know. Maybe you have your video closed captioned, or you have a transcript for it. Those are all ways that you can help people. So by presenting it two different ways. So yeah, you know, it's not as though you're going to say, I'm not going to put this on here because there's some people that can't benefit from that. All right, that's like the old, another terrible old saying. That's like throwing out the baby with the bathwater, right? You don't want to, who made up these old sayings? Who, did anyone ever actually throw away a baby when they got rid of, yes?
Yes.
Really?
Because, they would just have tubs for their families.
And yeah.
The way they would do it is, like, the man would take the bath first.
Right.
And it went down in order of age. So right. Like.
So the last one left? Yeah.
Yeah.
You
can't see them, but it's filthy.
Oh, man. Well, that must have been horrible. And yes, we don't want to do that, either literally or metaphorically, all right? I guess people tended to have more kids back then, you know, and like you might be like, you know, gee, do I have 8 or 9 kids? How many of them did I bath? You know, I don't know. Well, I think we're done. You know, let's throw away the bathwater. At any rate, I'm going to be thinking about that the rest of the lecture. I hope I can focus. At any rate, you know, we're not talking about eliminating content just because some people can't use that content. We're talking about providing them an alternative, all right? We didn't eliminate the room number out there, right, because some people can't see it. We put the number out there and we have Braille underneath it, all right? We don't force everyone to take the elevator, All right, we still have stairs in the building because stairs work for most people. But we do have an elevator to accommodate people that stairs don't work for. So multiple presentations, simplicity means make it as simple as possible. Multiple presentations say, well, we're not going to get rid of content necessarily, but we're going to provide alternatives across disabilities so that people can appreciate the site. Now again, you don't want overkill with this. The other hand, I don't know, I've tried to think of a horrible saying for that. You know, you don't want to beat a dead horse. Again, another horrible saying, right? You don't necessarily want to have a transcript and pictures and videos and audios and animation because, oh, multiple presentations is a good idea. You pick a couple of them that are going to be effective and that cover all the bases. All right? And that's the art of design, and that's the art of balancing these things out. All right? Okay, so last time we put up a list of disabilities. And what I want to do today is talk about the assistive technology that people have regarding these disabilities. And I want to talk about what we as designers can do to make sure that we're not beating their assistive technology, right? In other words, we could have elevators in our building, but if there's a staircase to get into the building without a wheelchair ramp, we've just beat that assistive technology, all right? Because people can't take a wheelchair up a flight of stairs easily. So we talked about vision and blindness, poor vision. There's a lot of ways people can have poor vision, right? But we'll just lump all those together. Or color blindness. We talked about hearing. We talked about deafness. We talked about partial hearing loss. We talked about motor control. We talked about extreme cases where someone would have paralysis. All right. Due to any number of conditions. We talked about poor motor control, also for a variety of conditions, arthritis, carpal tunnel, cerebral palsy, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, where the hand would shake, any number of these sort of things. We talked about neurological issues. And again, depending on how we score some of these things, some of the neurological issues are associated with motor control. So you could either put them in either category, but some neurological issues manifest themselves as giving poor motor control. But then we have things like epilepsy and seizures. Cognitive issues. Cognitive issues relate to issues in understanding. And ADHD, you know, is an obstacle to people understanding material. Dyslexia would be another issue. Possibly memory issues. And the one conclusion that we had is if you look at older people might have a little bit of all of these things going on, right? Older people aren't necessarily blind, but they typically don't have the best eyesight. Aren't necessarily deaf, but they can't hear particularly well, and so on down the line. So I go through this list, and I went through it this time, and I went through it last time, to show you, for one thing, that website accessibility is not just about websites for the blind. Vision is just one of the issues. And in fact, of the vision issue, blindness is only part of the issue, right? So, let's talk about assistive technology in each of these areas. All right? And assistive technology, broadly put, is any software or hardware that helps people get around the obstacles posed by their disability. All right, for blindness, all right, there sometimes are Braille readers that will take and output the text on the screen to Braille. All right, actually the Braille device moves so that it can be read. A very common example is a screen reader technology. And a screen reader or screen narrator essentially reads the screen to the person using it. Now, some of these things are built into operating systems. For example, there's a rudimentary screen reader built into Windows. And we're going to listen to that in a minute. All right? But usually people that have severe issues, there's other software that does a lot better job than the Windows screen reader, but it's typically expensive. And so just to get a taste of how a screen reader works, we'll go and we'll look at the one that's built into Windows. I hope we can hear this as well. Let me try turning up the volume. Okay, we heard something. All right, I hope I can find it under Windows 10. I'm going to guess settings. Ease of access. There we go. There's a number of tools under ease of access that can help people, and we'll take a look at those. And they can help people, first of all, with vision problems, and secondly, they can help people with other problems as well. All right. First is a narrator.
Settings. On. Narrator. Toggle switch.
It just told me what it did, that there was a setting for narrator, and it was a toggle switch. All right, choose a voice.
Selected, Microsoft David, one of two.
We can change it. It told me that I selected for that Microsoft David. Now, I'm not interacting this the way that I should, right? Because can
choose
blind people use
Microsoft
mouse?
David.
The mouse.
Combo box. Collapse.
Can blind people use, what do I want to say, mouses? Mice? Can the blind people use a computer mouse? Of course not. They can't see on the screen where to point. So how would they interact? Well, you can't interact. Go ahead.
Like the keyboard.
The keyboard, yeah. So typically what you can do on a form like this is you can tab through fields.
So off. Narrator, toggle switch. Off. Start narrator automatically. Toggle switch. Choose a voice, Microsoft David, combo box, collapse.
Okay. Now, how would I get to this without? I'd use a down arrow.
Selected, Microsoft Sierra.
Selected, Microsoft David.
A person told me if I wanted to really show my students the experience of someone using a screen reader, I should cut the mouse cord. This is back when mice had cords. A lot of people have cordless mice now. But you should turn off the mouse and turn off the monitor. And that's how you have to interact with it. And that's hard to do, all right? But at any rate, as you can see, you can imagine.
Caps lock.
Well, I hit the wrong
key. Caps lock.
I'm going to hit tab.
Speed. Slider at 10. Tooltip. Speed. Slider at 9. 8.
Okay, my eyes are closed.
7. 6. 5. 4.
What's this doing? It's changing the speed of the guy's voice. So I want to go to the next field. So my eyes are closed. I'll hit tab.
Pitch. Slider at 10. Pitch. Slider at 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Can't really tell what it's doing. Making it lower pitched?
Talking in a lower voice.
Okay.
On. Read hints for controls and buttons. Toggle switch.
It's kind of funny to hear this, and it's almost unimaginable to think this is how blind people interact with a computer, right? I mean, because you do this, just playing around with this window, it seems like such a tough task, all right? However, what other choice do they have than to do something like this? I did a summer fellowship at NASA, and I shared an office with a blind high school student. And this is how she navigated. She navigated via the use of a screen reader. And she was able to do most everything that you would expect a high school student intern to do. You know, make PowerPoint presentations, make Word documents, surf the internet, chat with her friends on Instant Messenger when she should have been working. All those things. All the things you would think a high school student would do at the time they were doing. Every once in a while, she would run into a problem that she didn't know what to do with, right? And she would ask me, like, what was on her screen, all right? And I'd come over and look at her screen. Most of the time, the screen wasn't even on, all right? And most of the time, the room was dark when I came in the morning, you know, because I'm not really much of a morning guy, so I got in later than she did. And she would get, and she'd be sitting in the dark with her computer off, with the monitor off, rather, with the computer on, and she'd be typing away and clicking tab and all that and doing everything. It's really amazing. Again, you don't know what you're capable of until you have to do it, right? So it's amazing people to blind. It was amazing for me that she was even able to find her way around Lewis Research Center to get to the right building, because I had a hard time doing that and I can see, all right? So really, it's amazing what people do when they have to. Let's open up a web page with this. So.
Desktop.
I'm going to speed up that a little bit.
Settings on.
Choose a voice. 13. Tool 11. 10.
We could do the opposite.
16. 7. 10. Internet usage policy. Google Chrome window. OK button. Internet usage policy. Desktop. Lorain County Community College. Real education. Real jobs. A real future. Tooltip, LCCC is your best value. Tooltip, where are you heading?
And how do you get around your tab?
Skip to content, link. Tooltip, highest paid grads. Value HTT, Lorain County Community College, real education. Real job, AZ index, link. Faculty/staff, link. Canvas, link.
So if I want to go to Canvas, what do I do? Hit the space. Oops.
Up arrow. Enter, untitled, desktop.
And now, bam, I'm in Kansas, right? This isn't the Wizard of Oz, I'm in Canvas.
Sign in, Google Chrome window, www.lorainccc.edu/register, linked, www.lorainccc.edu/schedule-planner, tab, value https://www.lorainup.edu/canvas-technology/schedule-planner/editable.
That was a little extreme with the speed,
slider 10,
but it is true. It is true that you can hear faster than people can talk, right? You know, so therefore, someone who is really adept at this could have it going faster than people would talk in a normal thing. That was a little fast for me, but, you know, if you were used to it, maybe not.
Tab. Password field.
Okay, so tell me that's a password. I think it told me before it was a username.
Hit in. Sign in button. Tab. Sign in. Helpdesk at lorainccc.edu. Link. https://tab. https://password.lorainup.edu/username, tab, double tab. Value https://www.lorainup.edu/canvas-technology/schedule-planner/password field. Sign in button.
That's weird. The username, it didn't seem to be. Anyhow. Ideally, it would tell you that you're in your username and then you're in your password and you could log on. All right. My purpose isn't to teach you how to use this. All right. It is to demonstrate the capabilities of it. So let's go and let's turn off the
settings.
Voice.
Speed slider at 11. Command not settings. Exiting narrator.
All right. Magnifier. I'm going to turn this on. And what do I get? I get the ability to take my magnification and go around the screen with the screen magnified quite a bit. I actually have a DJ on WOBC, Oberlin College's radio station, and one of the DJs that works the same day as me uses this because he has very poor vision. All right, and he'll use a screen magnifier to magnify it. Like if he forgets to turn it off, you'll go in and really the text will be like this big on the screen. All right, but he needs that to navigate.
Yeah, definitely.
So let's turn the magnifier off. You can invert colors with the magnifier and so on. You can configure this all sorts of different ways. Follow the keyboard focus. And so on. Let's turn it off. High contrast. That says my windows to look that way. And you could do that if you wanted to just to make your screen look different. Or you could do that because you have problems with your vision. And maybe this works for you better than the default theme does. Closed captions. If the content has closed captions, you can add that. Keyboard, you can put an on-screen keyboard. And what does that? It's almost like the keyboard on a phone where you can navigate a mouse. I had a student that had, I don't remember the condition, but she had very poor control of her arms to the point where typing was very difficult. But she was able to go and move the mouse around and type this way using the keyboard, much as like you would type on a phone. Mouse. Pointer size, pointer color, use the numeric keypad to make it easier, and then finally other options. All right, these are some of the assistive technology that comes right within Windows itself. All right. So, assistive technologies. Screen reader. Magnifier. Contrast. Are all things that would help with people that vision things. Those are the things that are built right into Windows, and Mac, I'm sure, would have very similar to that. In addition, there's additional software you could purchase that do some of these things better than the default Windows do. Hearing, closed caption. Motor control. On-screen keyboard. Keyboard shortcuts. Configuring the mouse. For seizures, there was something that said, don't play animations, don't play Windows animations. And I believe that's built into the browser as well. So you could choose to turn, in some cases, you have the ability to turn animations off. For cognitive issues, again, some of these things might come into play as well. maybe even be able to customize the theme. Now, those are the things that these folks can use. What can you do as a web developer to help or hurt people with this? Well, under vision, one of the things you can do is use alt attributes on the image. You can also put an extended description of the image. So for example, many companies, like if you go to LC's website, the logo, the image in the top of the page, the LC's logo, is actually a link to the home page. Without an alt attribute, the person wouldn't be liable to know that. But what you could do is put an alt attribute on it and say, LCC's logo, link to LCC's homepage. So that's why it's important when you create an image, you put your source in there, but you also put an alt attribute that describes what the image is showing. Now, that's a form of multiple presentation. Is that going to be as good as being able to see it? Of course not. But it does give people at least an idea. There's also, if I'm not mistaken, an extended attribute, extended description attribute. Let me look that up real quick. It's a long desk. And it's a link. Here's the example from the W3C site. So, you have a, let's say you had a graph here. You have an alt description that says graph of sales over past 2 months. All right, by week. So maybe the graph looks like this, you know. Here's the first week, here's the second week, here's the third week, here's the fourth week, here's the fifth week, here's the sixth week, here's the seventh week, here's the eighth week. So the graph looks like that, showing the sales. All right. You could then have description of the graph. That would say the first week the sales were low. Sales increased each of the next 3 weeks and hit a high in week four. Then sales started going down till it ended up a little bit lower than the initial value. So you could summarize a graph in words. All right. Again, would that be as useful as being able to see the graph? No, but at least it would give someone that can't see a description of what's going on there. This fits in a multiple presentation, all right? The description of the graph, some people would rather read a description than look at a graph. For some people, the graph is enough. And description of the graph is extra for people that would prefer it or for people that are visually impaired that can't see the graph, all right? So that's definitely something that a screen reader could pick up on and could allow someone who's visually impaired to access it that way. Great example of multiple presentations. So that's for blindness. That's some of the things we can do for blindness. All right. The screen reader will work as long as we don't break it. How do we break it? By not using alt attributes, and by, where necessary, providing a long description. What about some of these other things? What about poor vision or color blindness? What can we do for people that are color blind?
Use basic colors.
Use basic colors. All right. How do we know if our page works for a color blind person?
There's tools for that.
There's tools for that. Right. We don't have to track down people that are colorblind. Because really, I'm using the word colorblind, but really there's a variety of different kinds of colorblindness. It's not like everyone that is colorblind sees the same way. All right? So, one thing to do is don't use something more than color to convey your thoughts. So, for example, let's say I had information about medication. This is antibiotic that describes it. Then over here, I have a warning. Don't take if allergic to penicillin. It's blah, blah, blah. Now, to a person that can see colors, that should be enough, right? Because the color makes it stand out. Tells you that that's different, that that's important, right? Because if all the text is black on a page and you have one thing that's red, your eye's attracted to it immediately because it's different, all right? That's one reason why you don't just arbitrarily use a million colors, right? Because if you use a million colors, then what's different? Everything's different. So it looks like you're emphasizing everything, all right? So, red would work for people who can see, but what if you can't see red? What if red looks like gray to you? What could you do? Yes?
Put an asterisk
by it. What else?
Use larger font.
Change the font size. Yeah, make the font bigger. Make the font bold. Make the font italics. Put a border around it. There's any number of things that you can visually do. So with colorblind people, what will really help is, first of all, pick good color combinations. So I wouldn't use orange and yellow, for example, right? Because even people that aren't colorblind might have a hard time reading that, all right? But what I would do is I would use more than one thing, more than one visual cue to indicate that something special is about this, all right? So I would make it red and bold. I'd make it red and italics. Red italics and bold. Put a border around it. All right? Again, you don't want to overkill, but if you give different visual cues, then that's another way, other than color, to set that apart. And so people say, oh, there's something different about this. This text has a border around it that's drawing my attention to it. All right? Let's look at some of the colorblind filtering tools that you can use to test your website. Here's an image. And this is what normal trichromatic vision looks like. If you have red-green weaknesses, in other words, if you have red weaknesses, if you can't really distinguish red, then that's what the picture would look like. Green weakness would look like that. Blue weakness would look like that. Red blind would look like that. So these are different kinds of color blindnesses that someone can have. That works with the picture. There's actually ones that can test. Looks like there's a Chrome plugin for it. So I could put in a URL to this site. Maybe. So I could put in a website, and then I could filter it for how it'll look under a certain kind of color blindness. So let's look at Google. What you could do, you could take a screenshot of your website, upload it to here, and see how it looked with the different color blindness. There used to be one that was like the one that I tried that didn't work, where you could put in a URL and it would fetch it, and it would apply a colorblind filter to it. That didn't seem to be working today. But the bottom line is you could test for it. What about other vision problems, like just people that have poor vision? What are some things that you could do for those folks? Well, a lot of that comes down to basic web design. Make the text a good size. Make sure the text is readable. Pick a readable font. Pick fonts that aren't difficult to read. Pick very plain, straightforward fonts. Make sure that there's white space between paragraphs and between sections of your site, and so on. All right? What about some of these other things? For hearing, make sure you have closed captions, all right? Or make sure you provide a transcript. Captioning can be difficult, especially for a smaller organization. There's no straightforward way to do that. There are some automatic captioning tools, but the problem is unless it really has listened to a person speak, it's very difficult, and it comes up with some mistakes in understanding what the person's saying, and so therefore the captioning is incorrect. So you could have a transcript of it prepared if you had something that was a video. So closed captions, again, closed captions or a transcript, multiple presentations. People with motor control issue, again, a lot of that is solved by having your links big enough and isolated enough. Don't have small links right on top of each other. All right? And as we've seen with mobile devices, that can cause problems with them as well, where you interact differently and you don't use a mouse, but you actually touch the screen. So by providing the ability to have space between the links and the links of sufficient size, you make it easy for people that can click on it. Use keyboard shortcuts. You can actually integrate into your website keyboard shortcuts. If they press a certain key, it calls a link. Because for some people, the key using the keyboard is just fine. Using the mouse is what solves the what serves the problem. For neurological issues, epilepsy, and things like that, the answer there is simple. All right, don't use animation unless you absolutely have to, and provide an alternative. All right, so avoid putting in things that are just animations that look cute. If you're going to put an animation on your page to explain how something works, that's one thing, but maybe provide an alternative to that. All right, so that if someone is prone to seizures, they don't have to see the animation. They should go to a page that has still images along with an explanation. ADHD, dyslexia, memory issues. Memory issues, again, we could address by making sure we show people what links they have visited. Make sure our site has a consistent look so that people can easily find the navigation. Make sure our site has a consistent look so people know that they're on the same site and they haven't magically somehow gone to a different site. All right. Use white space to help people with dyslexia read. Use a clear font. Another thing you can do is if you give the ability for people to customize their fonts, that can help as well. Because, again, someone with dyslexia might be able to identify a font that is less of a problem. Now, many of these things, using white space, keeping it simple, giving a consistent look and feel to your site, make sure the font is clear and readable, and that your page isn't too cluttered, and there's not extra stuff going on, like extra animations and stuff like that. These are all basics of good web design. It's getting back to what I said originally, that when we talk about universal design, we're talking about developing websites that work for everyone, not just developing websites that work for people with certain disabilities. All right? So, there's other techniques. This is just meant to be an introduction. One of the things you can do is you can put a hidden link of your site on your site to allow people that are blind to skip your navigation. Right? Many pages have the same navigation on every page, right? Once you've heard it a few times, you don't want your screen reader repeating it. Well, you can provide a skip navigation that jumps past the navigation so you can start reading the content of the page. All right? When we talk about forms, which we will be talking about next week, I believe, there's things you can do with forms where people enter data to make it easier for people to understand that can't see the form. Finally, when we talk about tables, which we'll do probably the week after next, there are things that you could do to help people with tables. So just be aware of this. Be aware of it and use this. Keep these things in your mind as you're developing your sites. All right? The good news, again, is this doesn't contradict just plain old good web design. It very much goes hand in hand with it. It's just making some extra considerations to help people that have disabilities by possibly providing multiple presentations of the same content. Any questions about this? All right. We'll see you in lab. I will go open the door, then I will come back.